Hello and welcome to this session in which we would look at selling or factoring receivable. This topic is covered in intermediate accounting. This topic is very similar in idea to the pledging of receivable that we looked at in the prior session. And what's the idea? The idea is to raise cash quickly for the company. There are many reasons why we need to raise cash. Whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, I strongly suggest you take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA review course. My resources are a useful addition to your CPA review course. I help you understand the material better. I explain the theory behind the concept. Your risk to try me is 1 month of subscription. Your potential gain is passing the exam. If not for anything, take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university is doing on the CPA exam. This is a list of all my accounting courses: taxation, advanced accounting, managerial, governmental, intermediate, so on and so forth. My CPA supplemental courses are aligned to match that of your CPA review course, so it's easy to go back and forth between Farhat and your CPA review course. If you haven't connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation, like this recording, share it with other, connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. So why do we need the cash? That's the question. Well, we need the cash for many reasons. Do I have to explain why? We need it for payroll, supply, pay our suppliers, pay our bill, take advantage of certain opportunities. And as we mentioned earlier or in the prior session, we have two options. We can have a secured borrowing, use the receivable to pledge the receivable, or we can sell the receivable. In this session, we would look at selling the receivable. We're going to look at selling the receivable without recourse and looking at the receivable, selling the receivable with recourse. So how does it work? Well, it's very important to understand the parties involved in this process. And there are three parties involved. And here's what we're going to assume. We're going to assume that a customer comes to a company and they place an order. Before the company accepts this order, they're going to go to a factoring company. They're going to go to a bank, a factor or transferee. And the company, it's going to be the transferor, and we're going to see what does that mean in a moment. They're going to go to the bank or to the factor, and they're going to ask the factor whether they would be willing to finance this transaction. In other words, whether they were willing to give us the money to serve the customer, and the customer will pay later. If they say yes, if they approve, what are we going to do? We're going to go ahead and ship the product to the customer. That's good. That's excellent. And the factor is going to give us the cash for the sale. Then the customer will pay the factor. So this is how we're going to play this out. So we're going to assume the customer will pay the factor directly. Another way to do it is to first sell to the customer, so create the account receivable, then sell the account receivable to the factor. Selling the account receivable to the factor is easy. We're going to assume that the customer pays the factor directly. So this is the assumption that we are going to make as we are processing journal entries. Now, for a transaction to be considered sale, for a transaction to be considered a factor, we have to meet three conditions. And it's important to classify something, whether it's a sale, it's a factor, or pledge. Remember, we can pledge the receivable or we can sell it. Here are the three conditions that needs to be met. One, the transferred asset, which is the account receivable, is isolated from the transferor. Simply put, this is the transferor, the company. The company isolates this asset. So when they sell the receivable is not listed with their assets. It's listed separately. Also, it's not only that, it's transferred to the factor. Two, the transferee, which is the factor, once the account receivable is with the factor, with the bank can do anything with it. And what does that mean, anything? They can pledge it with another bank, with another financial institution. They can sell it. They have the right to do anything with that receivable. You basically have no control over this. And there is no side agreement between the transferor, the company, and the transferee, where the company will buy back the factor. There's no side agreement. All those three conditions should be met. So the answer should be yes for all those three conditions. If the answer is no to any of them, then the transaction is considered a secured borrowing. Then what we have is a liability, and we are going to record the expense, the expenditure to finance this transaction as interest expense. And this is what we looked at in the prior session. We looked at the transaction where we assume it's a secured transaction. So a secured transaction will fail any of these. In other words, if the company has a side agreement, then it's not really a sale. If the transferee cannot do whatever they want with the receivable, then we don't have a sale. Okay? If the transferor does not isolate the asset, the account receivable separately, then we don't have a sale. Okay? Now, what happens if the answer to these three questions is yes? Then we have another question to ask ourselves is the company have a continuing involvement in this transaction? It means the transferor. If the answer is no, then it's easy. We have a sale, and what happened as a result, we're going to reduce our receivable and record either a gain or a loss. Usually it's a loss. When you sell a receivable, no one's going to pay you more than the face value. So if you have a receivable of $1 million, the factor might pay you $960,000. Okay? In other words, they'll pay you $40,000 less. It means you have a loss. No one's going to pay you more than $1 million because the maximum they can collect is $1 million. If there is a continuing involvement by the company, and continuing involvement means what? It means the company says if they don't pay you, if the customers don't pay you, we will guarantee a certain amount. Well, we will still record it as a sale, but now we're going to be recognizing, in addition to the asset that we're going to be receiving, we're going to be recognizing a liability. And obviously, we will have a loss. We will have a loss. Simply put, when we sell and we have no involvement, we call this without recourse. When we sell the receivable and we have a continuing involvement, we say we sold it with recourse. So let's look at a summary of what recourse without and with recourse. With recourse, remember the company, the seller of the receivable, guarantees the payment to the purchaser. And they would say, look, if they don't pay you, we will pay you. We have a potential liability. Sales without recourse, well, the factor, the bank assume all the risk of collection. Basically, we're out of the picture. Once they say this is an agreement without recourse, once they give us the money, we don't have to worry about collecting the money from the customer. The transfer is outright sale. It's 100% the sale. It's your asset. It's your risk. It's your reward. So the seller record a loss. As I told you, it's usually a loss because no one's going to pay you more than the face amount of your receivable. I mean, why would they do that? Why will they pay you more than $1 million if the maximum they can collect $1 million? The best way to illustrate this is to work an example. Adam Inc. factors $500,000 of account receivable with the First National Bank. So First National Bank is the factor or the transferee. Adam is the seller of the asset. On without recourse basis. So this is without recourse. First National Bank assesses a finance charge of 4%. So First National Bank says, look, I'm going to charge you 4% of the amount of the receivable. And if we take $500,000 times 4%, they're going to charge us $20,000 up front. And they're going to retain an amount equal to 5% of the account receivable for probable adjustment. And they're going to say, if we're going to take $500,000 times 5%, that's going to be $25,000. Now, this is called a retainer. What is a retainer? Why would they keep this retainer? They're not going to give you the money now. Why? Because you made the sale. Every time you make a sale, you debit account receivable, you credit sales. But remember, at some point, customers might come back and say, look, we made the sale, we want a return. Therefore, you will debit returns and allowances, and you credit account receivable. So what happened, the company says, look, we're going to assume or we're going to estimate that 25% of those sales, they're going to be returned. Therefore, we're not going to give you the money because the customers may return the item. So let's take a look at the journal entry. The first thing Adam Company will do, if they factor $500,000, they have to remove $500,000 of the receivable. They're going to have due from National Bank, which is an asset. They're going to have an asset, a receivable of $25,000. Why? Because the First National Bank is going to withhold $25,000 for now. Why? Because customers might return the item. They may not return them. First National Bank collect all the money. They will give it to you. But we're not going to give it to you now. It's going to be receivable for you. So due from factor. We have a loss on the receivable. Remember, they're charging us 4% fee. We have a loss. So if we're transferring $500,000 of receivable, we're waiting for $25,000, and $20,000 is gone as a loss. What we're going to be receiving in cash today is $455,000. So this is the entry that Adam Company will make, the seller of the receivable. First National Bank, well, they're going to have an account receivable or a note, depending on what the deal with the customer. If it's a note, it's a note. It could be an account of $500,000. They expect to receive $500,000. If they receive the full amount, they're going to give you $25,000 because They did not give it to you now because customers might return the product. So this is basically a buffer, a protection for First National Bank, because they know some customers will not pay because if they return the product. If they return the product, they're not going to pay First National, and First National will not pay you. So we estimate that the amount will be $25,000. First National is going to book $20,000 of interest revenue upfront because that's their fee. That's their fee of 4%. 4% of the receivable is their revenue. And they're going to give you cash $455,000. So this is a sale without recourse. Remember, the $25,000, so due to customer, this is a liability for First National Bank, and this is an asset for Adam Company. If they receive the full amount, if no customers return the product, you Adam Company will be receiving an additional $25,000. That's fine. Simply put, the profit for First National Bank, if they collect all the money, well, that's the assumption, even if they don't, we're assuming that the due to customers is not collected, which is we don't have to pay it, then their gain or their profit is 20, or the revenue is 20,000. So this is without recourse. Okay? Now let's assume Adam Company sold the receivable with the recourse. With recourse means what? Adam told First National Bank, look, if you don't collect the money, we are responsible for giving you the difference. And now Adam Company will have to estimate what is the value of that recourse. What's the value of that liability? And we're going to estimate that the value of the liability, $7,000. Simply put, Adam thinks that we might have to cough up $7,000 in case the customers don't pay. Okay, so what are we looking at now? Now, remember, the cash received, $455,000. Why? Because we have $500,000 of account receivable minus $25,000 minus $20,000 of the 4%. So the cash we're going to give, the cash we are going to receive is $455,000. Then, if everything is received, we're going to receive an additional $25,000. So it's going to be $480,000. Then we think we are not going to receive $7,000. Therefore, we will do a less. We're going to deduct $7,000. So the net proceeds, we think it's going to be $473,000. What are we assuming here? We are assuming we're receiving today $455,000. Due from factor, that $25,000 buffer, we're going to get it. But there's going to be an additional customers that will not pay their bill, and that's going to be $7,000, where we're going to have to pay it back to the factor. Therefore, the net proceeds is $473,000. This is how much we expect. Now, if this does not occur, we will be receiving $480,000. Okay? If does not occur and everybody paid their bill, it means the $455,000 plus the $25,000, we will get $480,000. If some customers don't pay, and we're hoping it's going to be limited to $7,000, therefore, we're going to be receiving net proceeds of $473,000. Well, we are transferring an asset of $500,000. We expect to receive $473,000. Therefore, our loss is $27,000. The loss, $20,000 of it, is a fee of 4% times $500,000. That's the $20,000. And a $7,000, we're estimating that customers will not pay up to $7,000, therefore, we're going to have to pay back the First National Bank, which is a loss for us. So the loss is $27,000. Now, whatever happened, we really don't know. So let's look at the journal entries under this recourse agreement. So the cash we will be receiving is $455,000. Due from factor, it's going to be $25,000, because we assume $25,000 is, they're going to collect this, but now they don't want to give us the money now in case there is any sales, returns, and allowances. Loss on the receivable, we compute it to be $27,000. Account receivable, we're going to remove it at $500,000. And we have a recourse liability of $7,000. Hopefully, this liability never realized. Okay, if the First National Bank collects the money, we don't have to worry about this liability. So what is the difference between this entry and the prior entry? Well, in the prior entry, we did not have a recourse liability. When we did not have a recourse liabilities, our losses were $20,000. It looks something like this. This is the entry without recourse. Under the entry without recourse, our loss is only $20,000, because that's it. They're going to charge us a fee, and we're off the hook. Here, they're going to charge us a fee, and we still could be on the hook for $7,000. Up to $7,000, we think we're going to be on the hook for. Therefore, we have to estimate our total loss is $7,000, an additional $7,000. Remember, this is all estimate. If all customers pay, the maximum we would lose is the $20,000. But since we are on the hook, it's a with the recourse, and we think it's going to be $27,000. Now, if we estimate this to be $10,000, our loss will be $30,000. So we estimate it to be $7,000. Now, what's the journal entry for First National Bank? First National Bank does not really care. It has the same entry. First National Bank will have a receivable of $500,000, hoping to receive all of it. If they receive all of it, they're going to give Adam $25,000 in addition to the $455, and they have an interest revenue of $20. So that's it, their interest revenue. They don't have any more income. They don't have any more revenue. Okay? Why? Because that's the fee. If they could not collect, we will give them the money. We will give them the money, but they already gave us the money. They already gave us the $455, and they promised the $25. So if they don't collect anything else, we will give them the money. Okay, so simply put, they have a receivable of $20,000. They charge us twenty. It means they're gonna charge us $20 as a fee, $20,000 as a fee, and they are simply guaranteed $480,000. If we don't pay it, if they don't collect it, we will pay it. So they are guaranteed $20,000 of a profit. Now again, the $25,000, if they don't collect it, they don't have to pay it to you, because it's, again, if some customers return the product, and we estimate $25 is a good number. So make sure you analyze these transactions, look at them, and make sure to understand the difference with recourse, without recourse. Now on the CPA exam, they don't go that much in depth, okay? But if you understand this, you should be good to go. Again, at the end of this recording, I'm going to remind you, whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, to take a look at my material. I don't replace your CPA review course. Your CPA review course don't go in depth this much. The reason I go in depth, because once you understand this, well, you need it for your intermediate accounting course. But once you understand this for the CPA exam, they can throw anything at you and you'll be able to answer the questions. Now, on my website, I also have additional resources such as multiple choice that you can practice to see how this actually works. The CPA exam is a lifetime investment. Don't shortchange yourself. Throw everything on it. Good luck, study hard, and stay safe.